roller coasters.
First, we will begin with the quote-unquote free-fall ride Supreme Scream. It begins with a painfully slow ascension to the skies.
They do this by a pneumatic system that compresses air into stalling pressures and then quickly launches it vertically through a system of pipes designed to propel the riders and car upwards to the maximum height, in this case, 77 meters above the ground.
From here, they hold you for agonizing moments.
So they can again build up pressures with the pneumatic system to actually launch you downwards along with the pulley system so that you exceed free fall acceleration and reach a maximum of 4 Gs.
And just as you think that you're about to plummet to your death, they
once again use that magical pneumatic system of theirs to not only slow your descent down so that your innards don't end up all over the ground, but to also thrust you back up to approximately half of the maximum height and let you experience the free fall acceleration of 9.8 meters per second squared. For yourself and once and for all, slow you to a stop with compressed air.
So now for the physics behind the ride. The first step for majority of roller coasters is to create an abundance of energy to be used throughout the ride. In the case of Supreme Scream, this energy comes in the form of massive amounts of potential energy gained from the rise of the car and its riders to the maximum height of 77 meters, as mentioned before. As soon as the ride is released from its hold at the top, its potential energy due to gravity starts to convert into kinetic energy as the ride drops through the air, along with kinetic energy imparted onto it by the compressed air. As soon as the ride reaches a certain height, the pneumatic system kicks in again and starts to apply a force opposite the ride's direction, vertically downward at this moment, which provides negative kinetic energy to the ride. This kinetic energy is soon converted back into potential energy as the ride rises and back into kinetic energy as the ride goes through its final drop and descent.
The roller coaster seems to be these complicated pieces of machinery that require vast amounts of genius and knowledge to understand. They are in fact just applications of simple physics concepts with merely precise timings.
The next step in our exploration begins with a gargantuan loop, Montezuma's Revenge. This 36-second ride of terror not only speeds you through its loop once, not just twice, but also backwards, which they do by giving the ride unbelievably high speeds.
Well, they're able to do that because they use a flywheel or a system of wheels that attain high rotational speeds, normally with magnets and electricity, which they quickly transfer to another object, in this case, the train of cars, using the simple concept of energy conservation.
Once the ride receives its maximum speed of 89 kilometers per hour, it quickly goes to the most terrifying portion of its ride, its horrendous loop, which the riders painstakingly experience for what feels like an eternity.
In reality, however, the riders feel minimal amounts of forces as they go through the loop, as they're designed for comfort and nearly painless riding.
But the worst is yet to come, as the train travels up and down a tiring rise just to travel through the terrifying loop backwards at the same speed as before.
Not entirely true though, as the train must undergo a loss of energy because of unconservative forces such as friction and some air resistance, which means slower speeds as the train travels backwards.
Finally, as train and riders experience the loop backwards, they come to an abrupt halt to be left with the haunting recollection of Montezuma's Revenge.
Montezuma's Revenge is just a culmination of many physics concepts that we should know already. It begins with a flywheel imparting a high initial velocity onto the train through the high acceleration it has, giving the train enough speed and therefore kinetic energy to convert into potential energy to reach the top of the loop.
At the top of the loop, riders have both kinetic and potential energies that convert into kinetic energy as the ride descends down the other side of the loop. To go through the loop backwards, the train needs to somehow reverse the direction of its motion. This can be easily accomplished by traveling up a rise, where all the kinetic energy is converted into immense amounts of potential energy that is due to the train and rider's high mass and high zenith.
Once at the top, the train experiences a moment of no motion right before dropping and converting all the newfound potential energy into kinetic energy once more to travel through the loop one last time. On the return trip, however, the train is traveling slower than it was before because of the unconservative forces affecting its motion, sapping its energy little by little, which causes slower velocities in the end. After leaving the loop, the cars were quickly slowed down by a series of brakes that use tremendous amounts of friction to reduce the car's speed back down to zero.
The loop is an interesting prospect, as it was made to make it comfortable enough to ride through using the physics of rotational motion. As a rider goes through the loop, their tangential velocity, Newton's first law of motion, makes them want to travel in the same direction they were a split second before.
The only way the riders are able to travel through the loop safely is through a combination of two forces, the rider's weight and the centripetal force they feel because they're traveling in a circle. As the riders travel the loop, their tangential velocities are countered by the centripetal acceleration they undergo, always pulling them towards the center of the circle as the tangential velocity pulls them outward.
Lastly, we've come to the colossal steel monstrosity they call the Silver Bullet. This 2-minute, 30-second ride includes terrifying speeds and races through dozens of loops, twists, barrel rolls, and fear-inspiring corkscrew loops.
The truth is that there are only 6 places where riders are truly inverted: a loop, a cobra roll made of 2 inversions, 1 barrel roll, and 2 corkscrew loops, all of which apply minimal forces on the rider.
First off, Silver Bullet rises to the top of a high hill at 46 meters with the help of a chain lift system, gaining large amounts of potential energy due to the high mass of riders and train and the formidable height.
As the ride continues onwards, potential energy is converted into kinetic energy, which allows it to travel through the loop, experiencing the centripetal accelerations that allows it to remain safely on the track.
First off, Silver Bullet rises to the top of a high hill at 46 meters with the help of a chain lift system, gaining large amounts of potential energy due to the high mass of riders and train and the formidable height.
The corkscrew loop is just multiple vertical loops put together. The only difference is that you don't need to worry about potential gravitational energy that you start off with, because it converts to increasing amounts of kinetic energy as you reach the bottom of the corkscrew. This results in the strong centripetal acceleration one feels. And once more, you come to a halt by a braking system that is organized as a system of magnets that magnetically forces the train down to a velocity of zero. Although there are thousands of other roller coaster rides in America, they all utilize similar concepts of physics to operate. From centripetal acceleration to kinetic energy and to magnetism, these physics concepts have introduced the existence of roller coasters. Hey, soul sister.
Tonight.